Okay. So getting back to tracking that down from Wichita and going over this way, you know, you've been in your vehicle, you drove all around, and we're going to forget about Great Banff right now. But let's say you get out there, you're in the city, or you're out there on the Farmer John, and this is a section, you know, and you don't want to trespass on someone else's property because that's not a good thing, and it's just not a good thing to do. You know, you can drive all the way around, and you can see that the pressure seismically is in there with your equipment. You know, the pressure is huge right here. And you're getting in there when you're within, let's say it's over here somewhere. You drive all around, and you know the pressure is a little bit less over here, but over here and over here and over here, it's pretty close. But by the time you get in here, if you'd walk in on Farmer John's property illegally, you know, without his permission, you might get bent out of shape. You know, you might find some buckshot in your behind or something like that. And so let's not do that. So it's better just to look in. You know, if you're out there in a mountainous region too or something like that, you know, there's not as many roads out there in the mountains. So just look in visually and see where it's at. And then, you know, then you can go to it faster, you know, if you want to. But stay safe, you know, and use your GPS. Every time you come into these areas, you know, you come from Wichita or wherever, you need to use your GPS. Every place you stop, you get out your GPS unit, you mark exactly where it is, and then you keep moving in on it with your GPS unit. And then finally, when you locate where the epicenter is, you know, then you can GPS that spot, you know, or as close to it as possible, which would be, you know, you're talking less than a quarter mile here or something like that usually. And that's pretty good. So when you've used your GPS, that's how you figure out the magnitude of this thing. That's how you make the piezoseismic, the isoseismic maps, you know. I call them piezoseismic maps, but everybody's calling them isoseismic maps because that's how the USGS and all the other governments of the world make their maps. They call them isoseismic. And it's isoseismology, isoseismic, that kind of stuff. But anyways, you use your GPS, and that's how you figure out the magnitude by the different pressures coming in and how far away it is. So a basic rule of scale, let's get into this first here. So when you come in here, when you get really close, you know, when you get in under this half mile, you'll see the pressure really goes off the wall, and you start going up through the ranges. By the time you're within less than half a mile, you're going up really, really fast. And by the time you get in here to like something that's like a 2.2, you know, it's the pressure in here in the half mile, let's say a 2.2 or 2.6, and then the half mile, you're going up to, all of a sudden you're going from like a second range to like the 32nd range that quick, you know, in a half a mile's time. You know, but the time that I was telling you about the 6.7 that I had measured, you know, we're not talking about being here at the in the 32 range. We're talking about being clear across past Wichita, Kansas, doing the same thing, you know. That pressure is that fantastic, that far away as it was with these little earthquakes at less than a half a mile. So when you get the bigger earthquakes, the pressure is just unbelievable. You can't believe how much pressure it is. And it really makes me wonder how much it is on the volcanoes. And let me see. So the pressure on the volcanoes must be huge. But so that's how you're going to figure out the magnitude on these things, is by using a GPS to figure out exactly how far you are in a straight line anywhere that you come in from it. You're going to use your GPS, and that's going to figure out the magnitude by the pressure. You're going to mark down the pressure every time you stop, and you're going to mark down your GPS site to tell you how far away you are when you finally figure out where the epicenter is. You got to find out where that epicenter is. That's why nobody else in the world knows how to tell the magnitudes of earthquakes. But this is going to tell you the magnitude of the earthquake very accurately. We're talking less than a half a magnitude. And that's, you know, you're going to start off, you're not going to be that great. Some government's going to start off with this stuff. Well, it's going to be up to them to do all this isoseismic mapping, because I'm one person, I'm not going to go out and do all that stuff, you know. I want the other people to go out and become great and make these maps as perfect as possible for each area, and they'll be very accurate, and pretty soon they'll be able to forecast it down to 0.1 or 0.2 magnitude of what the earthquake will be. So now you know how to figure out what the magnitude is going to be. It's by using your GPS, making the isoseismic mapping to show where all the points are that you stopped, and then later on other people make points around the other way. Let's say, okay, and then you you came in, you figured out that the most pressure point was here. It was like a 32 range or something like that. But if it's over 6.7 or something like that, you're going to need to have other ranges. You know, it's going to cost you more money to up your equipment. You know, it's going to cost you some serious money. Even used junk equipment right now, I figure it's over $10,000 just to have a used junk equipment. You know, if you buy the stuff junky somewhere and for one of these units to go in. Okay, so you figured out how to do the magnitude, let's say, and you figured out how to find the epicenter. The epicenter is where you are on top of the ground, directly above the fault is running through there. You know, the most pressure is right there. That's where it's going to crack, or that's where it's pulsing right there. Even though you can see the full value of the fault. You know, when you're coming in here and you're doing the piezoseismic with your seismic unit. You know, you can't tell that this fault is there. I mean, you could be out there for a year if this thing was vibrating and you couldn't tell which way this fault was. I mean, it's that hard because this pressure doesn't seem to build up like this. It just builds up like this and like that, you know. It doesn't seem to build up along here for some strange reason. It builds up at a particular point where it's going to crack. So when you get the visual method is the only method that you can see the fault running through there, you know. And, how far can you see the fault at a distance? So what I've done is I've made over my years of experience of doing this stuff, I figured out